Well, I've been given the subject, the kingdom of God, and I have written a book on the subject. Kingdoms in Conflict covers the subject more than I can do in 2 hours on a Saturday morning. Let me begin by saying, you don't live in a kingdom. We're called the United Kingdom. I've news for you. We're not united and we're not a kingdom. Otherwise, it's not a bad name. But we haven't been a kingdom for over 1,000 years. Yes, we've got a queen, but you and I don't have to think about her at all in our day-to-day life. We never have to refer to the Queen for any decision we make. And I was just thinking how little contact I have had. We got a card from her just 2 weeks back because it was our diamond wedding. And apparently she sends a card to those who have a diamond wedding, which was nice of her. And it's a very good photograph of her. And we were glad to have it. Also, my son had a letter from her last week because I now possess the car that was built for her father, King George VI in 1939. It's a Daimler, if any of you are interested. When I was a squadron leader in the Royal Air Force, I had to swear loyalty to Her Majesty the Queen. And that gives me an idea as to why it's valuable to us to have a monarch. It's the power that she keeps from other people that makes the royal family valuable to us. So the forces are in the name of the Queen, not the Parliament. And our judiciary, which can sometimes be a bit awkward, but our courts are under the Queen. And that keeps the power away from others. And that's her value. She's a remarkable lady and she is a Christian, no doubt about that. Her Christmas broadcasts tell us that. But for most of my life, I've ignored her. And it hasn't affected me or her. We don't live in a kingdom now, not since King John had to sign the Magna Carta 1,000 years ago. And that began the process of taking power from the throne. The last king to try and be a king was King James, he who gave us the King James Version of the Bible, and he passed that desire for absolute monarchy onto his son Charles, and that cost Charles his head, because the people of England were not having a king who ruled. And so the Queen has very little power. There are 10 things she can do, and they're really quite small, but she does this superbly as a figurehead. But she's not the sovereign of the kingdom. She reigns, but she doesn't rule. And that's the difference. The first essential thing to a kingdom is a king. That may sound pretty obvious, but you can't have a kingdom without a king, and a king who rules, and whose will is law, and whose every wish binds his subjects to whatever he has willed. So we begin by saying that the most important thing to a kingdom is to have a real king, which we haven't had for 1,000 years. We have a constitutional monarch, And that means a monarch who doesn't rule and doesn't tell us what to do. And the other requirement to have a kingdom, a true kingdom, is to have subjects who obey the sovereign. And these are the two parts that make up a true kingdom: a sovereign who rules and subjects who are ruled. And only when you've got those two things do you have a kingdom. Now, there are a few kingdoms left in the world. One is Jordan. There's a king of Jordan, and it's the Hashemite kingdom of Jordan. And Saudi Arabia is another. And I have a book at home, The Story of Saudi Arabia, and it's simply called The Kingdom. And if you want to know what a kingdom is like, go and live in Saudi Arabia. And then you'll truly find a king who's reigning and ruling. And there, in a true kingdom, there are no elections, there is no parliament, no opposition, no votes. You can't vote the king in and you can't vote him out in a true kingdom. He has inherited that by being born into the royal family. And his claim is to be a hereditary sovereign. It was the Prime Minister of France who some years ago said of us that England is a republic disguised as a monarchy, and France is a monarchy disguised as a republic. And that's quite a profound remark if you think it through. But bless her, she doesn't rule. And therefore she doesn't rule me. She reigns, and that's it. And her son will become the king when she goes, though she seems to be here forever. And then we shall be the United Kingdom, but Scotland may have gone by then. And who knows about Northern Ireland or Wales. So we're not united, we're not a kingdom. And because we're not a kingdom, we don't really understand the phrase, the kingdom of God. And the trouble is, we treat God as a constitutional monarch, someone to wheel out for public occasions, someone who represents Britain as a kind of figurehead. But God is not like that. God is a king. And if you were in a Jewish home and you sat down for a meal, they would address God before they touched the food in these terms: King of the universe. And that's the basic Jewish understanding of God. In fact, in many languages of the world, king and God are the same word. So God is king of the universe. That's the first part of my talk today. He is king of nature. He is king of history. But he is king. And I remember a chorus I used to sing as a boy: God is still on the throne. And it used to give me a feeling of confidence. One little girl went home from Sunday school singing, God is still on the phone, God is still on the phone. And that's a lovely truth. But the real truth is, God is still on the throne of our universe. He is king. We should address him as your majesty. Wonder when you last heard anybody begin a prayer by saying, your majesty, we come with petitions to your throne. He is king of nature because he created nature. And here I want to say that the biggest enemy of our faith is not atheism, but deism. And there are people in our churches who really believe that God is what deism believes he is. And deism says God created the universe, but he is no longer in control of it. And therefore you don't pray about such things as the weather, because God has created nature, and nature now runs on its own laws, almost as if nature is a big clock. And God created the clock, but now it's wound up and ticking, and there is nothing that we can do about that, or even that he can do about it. Well, I know from personal experience that God can change the weather. I've only asked him to do that twice, but once was such a public occasion that it hit the news. And literally, I was on top of the moors in Northumberland, and for a public meeting without sight of any human building, we were sitting on hay bales in a big field. I was on the back of a lorry with a small generator to give me power. And the weather forecast was that afternoon a heavy band of rain would cross Northumberland right at the time of this big meeting. And they had even bought for me a complete fisherman's outfit with a cape and Wellington boots and waterproof trousers. I said, what on earth did you buy all that for? And they said, well, I'm afraid it's going to rain heavily in the middle of your meeting. And I said, but God organized this meeting, and he's not going to let a cloud of rain spoil it. And I refused to put it on. But the minute I got up to speak, the first drops came. And I watched this black cloud come straight for us. And I got angry with the Lord, and I said, Lord, you organized this meeting. You told me to come. And I ask you, Lord, to cut that black cloud in two. And you know, he did just that. And both fields on either side of us were drenched with rain, and I got sunburned. And that cloud literally divided and rained there and rained there. And we were in sunshine. They reported the miracle in the Farmers Weekly. So I know that God is in charge of the weather. He created nature and he can control it. And he not only started history, but he controls history as well. He is king of the nations. He is king of kings, lord of lords. And he controls things like the elections. He has the casting vote. I remember asking him at the time of our election many years ago, Lord, who are you voting for? And he said, Mrs. Thatcher. And sure enough, when the election came around, she came to be our prime minister. Now, that doesn't mean that God is a conservative, a Tory. Because about the same time I was in Australia, and there was a big bookstall in the airport, and there was a photograph of somebody. And as I looked at the photograph, the Lord said, that's the next prime minister of Israel. He was an aggressive trade union man, and very Labour, but God said, that's the next Prime Minister. And I began to announce it in Australia before the election happened and told them to start praying for him now, before he was elected, because he was going to be their Prime Minister, and were told to pray for those who govern us. And that people came to me and said, how dare you suggest that that boozing womanizer is going to be our Prime Minister? But he was at the next election, and he turned out to be better than they feared, because they had prayed. So I know from my own experience that God is King of nature and King of history. He's on the throne. That does not mean that everything that happens is God's doing. I shall say a lot about that in a moment. But it does mean that he has the last word, that he has the deciding vote in elections. And that means that he either gives us the government we need or the government we deserve. And that's an important difference. But he has the vote. Even in a democracy, it's easier to understand when there's only one person to be king, and that he can bring kings down and lift them up. But you see, in Europe, we are moving away from kingdoms. Since 1914, 24 crowned heads of Europe have disappeared. 24 kingdoms have gone. And those who've kept a royal family have cut them off from ruling and given them a figurehead's position. A constitutional monarchy prevails right round Europe now. So that less and less does Europe understand kingdom. And that's why just mentioning the kingdom of God means next to nothing. Whereas in the Bible days, almost every nation was a kingdom. And therefore the Bible doesn't ever define the kingdom of God. People would understand what was meant straight away, because they all lived in kingdoms. But it's a strange idea to Britain, and to most of Europe, the idea of a king who rules and who decides without a government, without elections, without a parliament, without opposition, without anything that we take for granted as democracy. And it means, therefore, that the Bible has no room for democracy. Now there's a headline for somebody if they want one. There is not a trace of democracy in the Bible. And when I went to see the film The Ten Commandments, I remember Cecil B. DeMille, who directed it, made a speech at the beginning. This film is about the beginnings of Western democracy. And I said, I wanted to shout out, no such thing. The Bible doesn't ever mention democracy. We are all made to be subjects of a king. That's when we find true freedom, when we are subject to a king who rules us. Why then don't we want a kingdom? Why do we relish democracy? Why do we love having an election? Well, it gives us the power. And we can kick a government out within 5 years of them being voted in. That's democracy. It gives us power. And that's one of the serious challenges to the kingdom of God, as we'll see in a moment. Well, now, the fact is that when you look at nature and at history, it doesn't look very much as if God is in control. And we've got to face that as a fact and come to terms with the fact that there are things that happen in nature, earthquakes, tornadoes, tsunamis, that kill hundreds of people. And it's not easy to believe in a good God in control. And when you look at history and you see the slaughter that has gone on with humans killing each other by the thousand, by the million, there has not been a period of 10 years in history without war. Not 10 years of peace. And there have been 36 wars since the end of the war, as we call it, in 1945. There are wars going on right now in Syria. And literally there have been 36 wars, sometimes international wars, sometimes civil war within a nation. And then we say, God is king of history. And people say then, why on earth does all this happen? And so human beings have tried to work out the contrast, the contradiction between what we see and what we believe. And there are many ways that human beings have ingeniously decided to solve the problem. One is called dualism, and that is the belief that there are two gods, one good and one bad, and they're at war with each other. And sometimes we benefit from the good one, and sometimes the bad one takes over. That's called dualism. There are others who say the answer is polytheism. Poly meaning many. There are many gods, and you've got to keep them all happy. What a problem we have if we believed in many gods. Which one have we upset? That's the first question when things go bad. But then there have been real debates about God himself. And here is the big dilemma. Is God all-powerful? And is he good? If he's both of those, why doesn't he stop the wars? Why does he allow famine? Why do the bad things pass him? Why does he seemingly turn a blind eye to what's happening in our world? And so people have come up with either the statement that God is weak and that he can't solve the problems and that he's waiting for us to help him. I listened to a bishop on the TV preach that, and he said, God is weak, he is as weak as water, and he wants us all to rise up and help him to solve the problems that he has with our world. That's not the answer. But even inside church, I'm hearing that answer, that God is weak. Well, now, if he's all powerful, you've got to tackle the other question and say God is not good and that he's playing games with us and that we are helpless in his hands and therefore we can't complain. He is God and we're just his creatures. We've got to accept that it's his will to have good and bad things happen to us. Neither of those answers is the Bible answer. The Bible states all the way through, God is good and God is almighty. So we're left with the question, then why do things happen as they do? I'm starting with that problem because until we face it squarely and honestly, we won't understand the rest of the Bible teaching. Quite frankly, it means that there must be more than one kingdom operating in our world. And that's the Bible answer. There is a multitude of kings, and every member of the human race wants their own kingdom. That's the first answer of the Bible. The very first human beings said, God, we're not going to let you tell us what to do. We will decide for ourselves what's good and bad for us and what's right and wrong. And Adam and Eve made that choice. They wanted their own kingdom, a little kingdom of themselves, but it was their kingdom. He's not our king. We're not his kingdom. And if we like the fruit of that tree that he's forbidden us, we'll have it. We'll taste it and decide for ourselves whether it's good for us or bad for us. And the truth is that every one of us has been touched by that desire to have our own kingdom. With many women, it's their home. This is their nest. And they will have that kingdom as they wish it. They're queen of their home. The family can be your kingdom, and you can rule it like a king or queen. But take other areas of life in our society. How have we seen kingdoms grow in the commercial world? Person starts with a small business, and then it must grow and must be bigger and bigger because the boss wants a big kingdom. And he will soon have a kingly car to drive in and soon have branches opening everywhere. And there is hardly a human being who's gone into business who hasn't started building up his own kingdom, preferably with his own name everywhere. In the political world, you find again and again a politician wants to build himself as king and build a larger kingdom that he can control. We see it, alas, even in the church realm, where a man sets up a church and then he wants more churches under his name, and pretty soon he's building his own kingdom. That's not what we mean by the kingdom of God. It's the ambition of a man to have his own kingdom, and a bigger and bigger kingdom. And so we go on, and I can spend the rest of this morning just talking about all these kingdoms that men are building for themselves. Even at a very humble level, most men would rather be their own boss if they could have their own business and make their own decisions as to when they work or when they take a job on or not. And it leads to contentment. One of the most contented jobs I've ever come across is that of a Thatcher, working for himself, deciding when he works and what works he wants to do. And he's a very contented man. That's his kingdom. And within that kingdom, he's boss. And he's reigning and ruling. So it happens in almost every sphere we touch, this rebellion against God that says, you're not to be king of this, I'm king here, or I'm queen here, and you don't tell me what to do. That's sin, as the Bible calls it, to be your own boss and to declare independence from God. So we have, first of all, to say, not only is God king of the universe, human beings are kings and queens in their own little kingdom. And that's not the kingdom of God either. And yet behind all these human kings and kingdoms, there's something else the Bible says. And that is that the devil is king of this world. And between the fact that man is king and the devil is king, you can explain everything bad that is happening in this world. Now let's begin here by saying that it's vital to accept the Bible teaching that human beings are not the top of creation. Now, evolution has so got hold of us that we now think of man as the top of creation, as the most developed creature there is. And that makes us rather proud. But we are not the top of creation. We are above the animals and below the angels in God's creation. There is a whole range of life above us that has more intelligence than we have, more strength than we have, and more speed. Angels can travel around the universe far quicker than Concorde. Now, unless you really do believe in angels, you won't understand the worldview of the Bible. So there is a whole level of creation above us called angels, and they are superior to human beings. And we need to remember that. And just as human beings have rebelled against their Creator and said, we want our own kingdom where we rule and where our will is applied, the same thing has happened among the angels. And one third of them have rebelled against the kingdom of God in heaven. And this is an insight that is essential to understanding the Bible worldview. And among these one third of the angels who have rebelled, they have been led by an angel called Satan, who behaves like a dragon, who has his own kingdom, and his kingdom is this world. And he is called in our Bible the God of this world, the Prince of this world, and the ruler of this world. And the New Testament says, we know that we belong to God, but the whole world lies in the hands of the evil one. Now we begin to understand why the world is in a mess, because it's in rebellion against the kingdom of God. Human beings are in rebellion and want to be the landlord of earth and not the tenant. Angels have set up their own kingdom, and that kingdom is this world. Do you know that Satan has even managed to change the Lord's Prayer so that we never pray it properly? Because it mentions Satan as Jesus gave the prayer. And he said, when you pray daily, begin with God and his needs and his concerns, go on to your own needs and concerns, but finish with, deliver us from the evil one. And as soon as we say that, you realize that Satan is mentioned at the end of the Lord's Prayer. But he has persuaded the church to say, but deliver us from evil. As if evil is a thing and not a person. And that, of course, is one of the first tricks of Satan, to persuade us that he doesn't exist as a person. And that evil is a thing. And that the origin of evil is the origin of this thing. But evil is a person, is persons. Because with a third of the angels with him in his rebellion, he can have agents over the whole world. Sometimes we blame Satan for what is not his doing. Can be a demonic doing. He has set princes of evil over each country and region, and he uses them to deceive us. Because if there's one thing characteristic of the devil's kingdom, it is deception. And he is the greatest liar there has ever been. Jesus called him the father of lies. And he has deceived so many, even Christians, by telling lies and propagating untruths. Let me just run through the other characteristics of Satan's kingdom, since his kingdom is this world, and he really does rule it. Darkness is characteristic of Satan's kingdom. Light is the kingdom of the Lord. We've come into his light from the darkness. Satan never opened a day club. It was always a night club. And most of Satan's evil is done at night, in darkness. In Nazi Germany, the Gestapo came to arrest you at 3 o'clock in the morning, when you didn't expect them. And that was characteristic of all the Nazi Gestapo arrests of the Jews and of the enemies of the state as they saw them. It's a kingdom of darkness. Satan loves to hide things. He hates being brought to the light, and his works brought to the light and exposed for all to see. And we are the light of the world, as Jesus himself was. And part of the light's function is to expose things that are hidden in the dark. So Satan's kingdom is a kingdom of darkness, a kingdom of deception, a kingdom of disease. And that's one of his biggest weapons in the human field, to bring to naught the activities of God through disease. I mention that because I'm building up to the kingdom of Jesus, which includes liberating people from the disease that Satan brings on them. But that's anticipating my second talk. The kingdom of darkness, disease, deception, and it's a kingdom of division. The easiest way to conquer an enemy is to divide them. And Satan loves to divide Christians from one another. His kingdom is built on division. among human beings. And the final D I want to give you is, it's a kingdom of death. And sooner or later, he is a killer. And if you've done any work among young people, you will hate Satan. When you see what he does, walk the streets of Bath in the early hours of the morning, and you'll see what he's doing to young people. He's killing them with drugs, with artificiality, and sooner or later, they are dead. Now, I'm not talking about physical death, though it does include that under the realm of disease. I'm talking about spiritual death, to be dead to God. And that's one of his objectives. He wants people dead to the Father. When the prodigal son came home, the father said, "This, my son, was dead." But he wasn't. He was living it up in Antioch, which was the more ancient Paris. And he'd been living it up and spending all his money and having a great time. But all that time, he was dead to the father at home. And it's that kind of death which is characteristic of Satan's kingdom, a deadness to God. And look around the people in your neighborhood. Go and talk to them about the gospel and see what reception you get. And it's amazing how utterly dead they can be towards spiritual things. There is no response. There is no real life in them. It's gone. And that kind of death is a horrible kind of death. People are still alive, but they're dead. And it needs the power of resurrection to bring them to senses. Well, now here we have an explanation of the Bible as to why this world is in such a mess. And it's been in such a mess from the very beginning. It is because people have rejected the will of God as their rule of life. And because angels have also rejected. And therefore, when Jesus came, he said, "I must spend time with Satan before I spend any time with people." Interesting priority. But he recognized the real power that was holding people in their grip. And he says, "Unless I first bind this strong man, I can't liberate his victims." Now that doesn't make sense to people who don't believe in angels and who don't believe in a personal devil. They haven't got those clues to handle the situation. And they therefore are left with blaming God for what things go wrong. And I think that's the kind of unfairness that you're led into, the lie of Satan, that God is to blame for the things that happen that are painful and uncomfortable to us. We blame God. We blame God for the wars that we start and that we fight. Why does God allow this war? But he didn't start it, and he's not responsible for it. But you see, if you only have a vague idea that God is in total control of everything that happens, you're locked into blaming him for the bad things. And that's how people suck into the devil's great lie. I want to present you with the big question which all this raises. God is saying, "Why do you want me to be sovereign when you don't want to be my subject? Now that's a crucial question. And if I leave you with many questions today, that's the one I hope will stay with you. Because that has been the problem all the way through. We want God to be sovereign, but we don't want to be his subject. And when I say we want him to be sovereign, I mean sovereign according to our will. We all want God to do things that we decide he should be doing. And we're not willing to be his subject. And the whole story of the Bible is round that question. He asked ancient Israel, why do you want me to be sovereign when you don't want me to be, you don't want to be my subjects? It is hypocrisy to be praying that God will step in his sovereignty and put things right if we're not willing to be his subject. And many of our prayers, even the prayers in church, are telling God what he should be doing as sovereign, that he should be stopping all the wars, that he should settle the Syrian issue. I hear it almost every Sunday in church. Let me sharpen up the question by putting it this way. Have you ever wanted God to be sovereign over your body? And I mean by that, we can say to God, cure this disease, take the pain away, put my body right. We're telling God what he should do. Now he can do all these things, and we want him to be sovereign over our bodies. But are we willing for him to deal with our gluttony, or our lust, or all the other things our body wants to do? To ask God to heal our bodies when we're not willing to put our bodies under his rule is sheer hypocrisy. But so many human prayers are pleading with God to be sovereign. Prayers for revival in churches which are disobeying the will of Jesus, praying for God sovereignly to step in and revive the nation, at the same time as we are deliberately disobeying the will of Jesus, who is head of the church. You see what I mean? This is the heart of the problem. This is why the kingdom of God is not to be seen in our world. It is only there for the very discerning to see. But for the average person living in Britain today, they cannot see the kingdom of God. And therefore they take no notice of it. Why should they? It's because God wants to be sovereign, and therefore he wants us to be subjects who willingly and gladly accept his rule over our lives. And when we say that, we mean over every department of our life, every department, our work, our leisure, our money, our ambitions, our health, yes. But if we say, God, heal my body, but I'm not going to let my body do what you want to do, that is just sheer hypocrisy. And it's little wonder that God does not listen to prayers that try and make him be sovereign on our behalf.